everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
I know that God is here, and I know that God is omnipresent. And I know right now in this sanctuary, there's just a handful of us, but the Spirit of the Lord is here. And I know that He is talking and moving in some of your homes right now. You can say it to the screen. I know you can't see me physically, but you can say, thank you, Jesus, where you are. God has been good to us. God is taking care of us. God is still in control, and we have a right to be happy people this morning. I'm excited about what God is doing and what God is going to do in this place this morning. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. And I know some of you feel it right now. Take a couple seconds and praise and magnify God where you are. God is the answer to what it is that we're facing. God is what we need more of this morning. I feel the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And He needs Jesus this morning. Thank you, God, for your opportunity. I'm going to call that. Doing what we did last week, we have to observe social distancing, and this is the part of the service that drives me the most crazy, because I love fellowshipping, I love hugging people's necks, I love shaking people's hands.
All right.
We can't do that anymore. We're spread out, just a handful that are here. We're on very far views. So what we're going to do is we're just going to look at one another right now and socially distance, greet one another in the name of Jesus. Anybody wants to give a hug? Give a social distance hug. One of these days, I believe the song says, soon and very soon, we're coming out of this thing.
Yes.
We're going to be back in this building with all of you watching that are within driving distance. We want you in this building with us when we get back. And man, we're not going to have to social distance anymore. We can grab each other's necks and love on one another. But I'm thankful this morning to be able to be here. I want to thank everybody for tuning in with us. I do have a little thought on my mind. I've been reading and watching a sermon series on when the children of Israel went down into Babylon. And they were taken captive and went down into Babylon. They had a man of God that was speaking to them, and they didn't want to hear what he had to say because he was telling them, you're going into captivity. You're going into captivity. And the news of the day was what they wanted to hear. Now it's the opposite of where we find ourselves. We're in a situation that I know every one of us, every single one of us here, every single one of us watching, if there was a way that we could snap our fingers or wave a magic wand or do something, we would change the reality that we find ourselves in right now. Where we would be able to gather again on Sunday mornings together with our brothers and sisters of like precious faith, where we would be able to go to our jobs and just go back to what we do as normal, but that's not the situation we find ourselves in. But it was interesting to me as I was studying this out. The man of God, he told the children of Israel, he told the leaders, he said, you're going into captivity, and you're going to be down there a while. But when you get down there, and you find yourselves in Babylon, I want you to build houses. I want you to plant vineyards. I want you to have children. I want you to succeed and prosper as much as you can in captivity. And I want to speak to somebody this morning that's watching. We find ourselves in a situation that we would all change if we could. But we do not have to be paralyzed by fear in the situation that we find ourselves in. We can prosper right where we are. You can love your family right where you are. You can read now more than ever. You can pray and talk to God. Succeed right where you are. You may feel like you're in captivity this morning. You may feel like there's anxiety and fear all around you. But as a man of God, I'm here to tell you under the unction of the Holy Ghost that we have an opportunity right now, not on May 1st, but where we sit this morning, to be in the presence of God, take advantage of it, cultivate it, grow it, and don't be surprised when we come out of this and you're much stronger than you are this morning. Give the Lord a big hand by wherever you are. I do want to make a few short announcements before we're going to have Pastor Brown come up and deliver the message that God has laid upon his heart for this morning. For those of you that are watching on Facebook right now, if you have not already, this is really, really a good opportunity for us to extend the reach of what it is that we're trying to do. So I ask you, if you're on Facebook Live right now and you have not, please like the church Facebook page, Apostolic Pentecostal Church. What this does is when you like that, any announcements, any information, any sermons, any videos that we post, you will automatically have access to by hitting the like button that's probably right above where you're watching now. Also, if you see the tab that says click to invite your friends, if you click on that tab right now on Facebook, What that will do is it will bring up your entire Facebook friends list where you can send them a personal invitation where they also can like the Facebook page, and then they will have access. So every Sunday morning when we go live, if they're on Facebook, they'll get a notification that Apostolic Pentecostal Church just went live. We can really, really reach people. With the sermon that we had just last Sunday, we reached almost 1,200 views. I've had views from all over the world. I got a friend request this week from the Philippines, from someone that has watched our video. They're watching this morning, so if you're there, let us know you're there. If you're watching this morning, please put "I'm watching." That way we can have access and know that you're watching.
Right.
We can comment with you. This is the best way that we have available right now to stay connected.
Amen.
Also, the children that feel probably are feeling the brunt of this more than anything, being the social creatures.
Gage, you gotta stop watching videos.
It has been doing a thing every Friday evening around 6:30 on an app.
Here.
We will continue to do that through this stay-at-home order. We have our Sunday morning, which is at 10:30. We have our Thursday evening Bible study, which we have at 7 o'clock. There is one thing that I'm going to add to this, seeing how this is going to continue. I thought it was just going to be a two-week period, but because this thing is going to continue into or through the length of April, I have asked for my calling, my outreach director, if he would be willing, he said he would, to conduct a live stream at home. Be in the privacy of his home at 7 o'clock on Sunday evening. So we want you to know that we are going to have a devotional Bible study. I left it up to Brother Mike, whatever he feels directed, but it's just something to add to the mix, seeing how this thing is going to be extended. He was willing to do that for us, so he will do that this evening. So this evening at 7 o'clock, tune in. Brother Mike Klein will be ministering to our hearts through the duration of this stay-at-home order on Sunday evening at 7 o'clock. He will be on the Facebook and will be on the YouTube. You will be able to do that at home. So just understand there's going to be ministry during this period of time. Thank God for technology. What would we do if we didn't have this in this stage that we're going through, or season that we're going through? Some of you are more tech savvy than I am, but that's an age thing. I am getting a little more inclined to use technology, thank God that we have. Thank God we're able to make this connection. Thank God that we're able to get these children together. Not only are the children getting together on the Zoom page, I think the youth are doing it also on Sunday evening. They're connected, staying connected. That's what we need to do in this period of time, in whatever way that we can, without actually being in one another's presence.
Right.
On the bright side, those of you that are home, when we do get back together, the best for you should be done. That's a bright note. Think on that. The best of you will be done. Just moving along, and Sean is doing a wonderful job correcting a lot of things that were messed up. He is homeschooled, and he attempted by April 1st, but due to the circumstances, not able to do that. But this coming, Brother Dean. You'll be home before too long. But I do appreciate him tuning in this morning. We do appreciate all of you. I know that during this period of time, they have also closed barbershops.
Yeah.
And some of us are starting to look a little shaggy. I'm going to try to do what I can through this period. My wife has offered to cut my hair. But if I come in here and you see me looking with an homish haircut, you know my wife's got it. She just puts a bowl on there and zip around there. But we just have to do what we can. If I come in here with that, Albert Einstein look, we're just sticking everywhere. Just bear with us. This too shall pass. But we do appreciate the Lord. The Lord has been good and gracious to all of us. We're able to still worship the Lord, able to hear His word, and that's so important in these days that we live in. God's been good to all of us.
Amen.
We trust that all of you are well and all of you are safe this morning. Continue to do that. Continue to be safe and do what you need to do. We will be back together again. And it will be soon. I know, when everything comes to a screeching halt, it changes in your life. The days seem like weeks. This hasn't been that long, but it seems like it's been months. And it may feel like it's almost an eternity, but when we look back on this, it's just going to be a little blip on the radar screen of our life. Just a small segment of time. But let's just do what we need to do. And we'll continue to endeavor to bring you the word of the Lord. I would ask you to stand with us this morning as we direct your attention to the word of the Lord this morning. We're going to turn your attention to Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21. And I'm going to pick up reading of verse number 1, and we'll read through verse number 5. Matthew 21. Beginning at verse number 1. And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem, and were to come to Bethany, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied, and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, The Lord hath need of them. And straightway he will send them. All this was done, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell ye the daughters of Zion, Behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt the foal of an ass. From verse number 4, it says, All this was done, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. By the help of the Lord this morning, I'm going to speak to you on this daughter's subject so the word can be fulfilled. All this was done so the word could be fulfilled. Lord Jesus, we come before your presence this morning, thanking you for another opportunity, Lord, to stand before your people. Lord, into the breaks of bread of life. I pray, Lord, for these next few moments of time that we come by here. Lord, that you would speak to our hearts and our minds of your word. Lord, I pray that you would anoint your servant that our thoughts, our words here today. Lord, let this word be a help, a ministry, Lord, to all those that are hearing this word today. Lord, reach out and minister to each and every soul, we ask and we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless your hearts. You may be seated this morning. The scripture says that it might be fulfilled, the words might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet that the scripture is in reference to is Zechariah. In Zechariah, the 9th chapter and the 9th verse, the prophet prophesied and said, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding upon an ass, and upon a colt, the foal of an ass." This scripture in Matthew 21 and verse 4 is in reference to the words that Zechariah spoke, words of the prophecy or prophetic prophecy of Christ. Your king is going to come unto you.
Yes, sir.
You need to rejoice.
Amen.
This is how he's going to come. He's going to come meek. He is going to come riding upon the foal of an ass. When Jesus entered into Jerusalem, which today is what is known as Palm Sunday, a week from today is Easter. This is Palm Sunday. There's a reason why it is referred to as Palm Sunday. And it is in reference to this story that we have read to you this morning. It was Jesus' final, or what we refer to as his final, but it was not actually technically his final entry into Jerusalem.
Right.
He was entering into Jerusalem. This is known as the final week, or the week of Passion,
All right.
Leading up to his crucifixion. And this was all going to fulfill the scripture, or to fulfill the word of God. When Jesus came, when they were come unto Bethany, by the Mount of Olives, he instructed two of his disciples. The Lord sent two of his disciples to go to this village. And when you go there, you're going to find an ass, and you're going to find this colt that is tied with her. I want you to bring them unto me. And if anybody asks anything or questions you why you're doing it, just say, "The Lord hath need of them." And they'll let you bring them. So they brought this colt and this foal of an ass, and they brought it unto the Lord. But it was all done. This was not just by chance. Jesus could have entered into Jerusalem like he did the following day.
Right.
But the Lord knew the scripture needed to be fulfilled. The reason why, and the only reason why, that he sent two disciples to go get this colt, this foal of an ass, was simply to fulfill scripture, or to fulfill the word of God. I emphasize that this morning because we need to understand that the Lord will do whatever needs to be done to fulfill his word. He will not let one word fall to the ground.
I believe that whatever God's word has stated to us, we can take it to the bank.
Amen.
Even when it seems like there's no way possible for this to happen, the Lord is going to make sure that the word of God is fulfilled.
Amen.
This is where he began to ride into Jerusalem on this donkey. You can read on down where they began to, a crowd gathered, and they began to praise him and began to magnify him. In verse number 9, it says, the multitude that went before and then followed.
Right.
In other words, there was a group of people that was in front of him, and there was a group of people that was behind them,
yeah.
And it was just this crowd of people that was going with him as he was riding this donkey. They began to cry, saying, Hosanna, which means save now. Hosanna to the Son of David. They were recognizing him as their king. And they said, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. They were excited. They were rejoicing. Just as the prophet said for them to do, rejoice. For your king is coming.
Amen.
He might not be entering into Jerusalem like any other king would enter. He is just simply riding this donkey into Jerusalem. It was in this story of his triumphant entry that the crowd that was there, some of them began to take off their garments. They would take off their outer garments, a coat or a cloak or a mantle, and they would lay it down in the path where he was traveling. Then it said there were others that took branches from the tree and laid them down. And that's what you will read here in Matthew 21. But in John's account of the triumphant entry, John 12, 13, you will read where the branches were branches of palm trees. Therefore, you get this name Palm Sunday, because the branches that they laid down were palm branches. This is the only place where you read it is in John 12, verse 13. But it was to the crowd a joyous time, a glorious time. But in their minds, they thought that their king was going to set up an earthly kingdom. But this was not going to be the case. This was not what the Lord intended to do. Oh, he is the King of Kings. And he is the Lord of Lords. And he still reigns supreme this morning. He still is in the control of the affairs of men. But he is not setting up an earthly kingdom. His kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. They did not recognize this. At this particular moment, they were praising him as their king. They were saying, Hosanna, or save us now. This is going to be our deliverer from an earthly power. But this is not what the Lord was intending to do. He was intending to set the captive soul free. He was intending to set the spirit of man free, to set the soul free, of man, to redeem man. That was his objective. It was only a week. It was only 7 days before his crucifixion, this passion a week. Little did this crowd know that they would be denying the Lord. Little did this crowd know at this particular moment that they would be forsaking the Lord. It was a time of triumph. It was a time of victory, a time of celebration. But this needed to be done to fulfill the scripture. We read here down in verse number 17 of this first or 21st chapter. And he left them and went out of the city unto Bethany and lodged there.
Yeah.
triumphant entry was not technically his final entry into Jerusalem. But this entry into Jerusalem had to happen this way. Simply because there was a prophet by the name of Zechariah that prophesied this. And the Lord was not going to let a word of that prophet fall to the ground. For you will read in verse number 18, now in the morning as he returned into the city, he hungered. Yeah. He didn't return getting another donkey and riding into Jerusalem.
Right.
He could have walked into Jerusalem just like he did then and just like he did before. But the reason why we have this entry into Jerusalem with the donkey is because it was prophesied. Because the prophet said, this is how your king is going to come. So the Lord says, we've got to fulfill this scripture. So he sent two disciples to get this donkey.
Yes.
Just so the word of the prophet might be fulfilled. We need to understand something this morning. As we view this time and view this season and view this passage of scripture of Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Just as the Lord made sure that he did what needed to be done to fulfill scripture. And you can read this over and over in the Word of God, in Christ's ministry. This was done to fulfill what the prophet said. This was done to fulfill the scripture. Over and over, he made sure he did it to fulfill the scripture.
Yeah.
He intentionally did things to fulfill the scripture. And this is just one of those intentional acts that he did to fulfill what the prophet of God said.
Amen. Yeah.
We need to understand this morning, God's word is settled in heaven. This world can be in an upheaval. This world can be rocking and reeling. This world can be being blown by the turmoil of the winds of adversity. But God's word is settled. This word is settled. This word is going to be fulfilled. That which has not been fulfilled yet will be fulfilled. God will make sure that it's fulfilled. I'm going to turn your attention to James chapter 2. James chapter 2. And I'm going to pick up reading at verse number 1. It says this, or 21, I'm sorry, 21. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son upon an altar, on the altar? See thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. Verse 23, and the scripture was fulfilled which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. And you can read in Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6 where this took place. The Lord brought Abraham, and the scripture said he brought him forth abroad,
right,
in verse 5. And he said, I want you to look. I just want you to look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou art able to number them.
Right.
And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be.
Right.
Now, question. You can read this 15th chapter, the first part of it. He's questioning the Lord about this promised seed that he was going to give him.
Right.
And it had not yet happened yet.
Yes.
And the Lord just took him abroad. The scripture says, I don't know what exactly it meant that he took him abroad, but he definitely took him where he could look up into the heavens.
Yeah.
And see the stars. Maybe he just took him outside. Look up there into the heavens. You see all those stars? He says, so shall thy seed be. Verse number 6 is what James is in reference to. He said he believed the Lord and he counted it to him for righteousness. So this is the verse of Scripture that James is in reference to when he says about Abraham having this imputed unto him for righteousness. He believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness.
Amen.
What he was believing was he was believing in the word that God told him. He was not believing in something that was tangible to him.
Right.
He was believing in what the Lord had told him.
Amen, brother.
And when he told him that, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, was when he was in reference to believing the promised seed was going to be given to him. Even though he felt dead in his body, even though his wife was dead in her body, what he believed was that my God is bigger, my God is greater than my body and my capability. I'm gonna believe just if he said my seed's gonna be like the stars of heaven, I'm gonna believe it. James picks up on this and he says, in regards to Abraham's faith, he connects this scripture in Genesis 15 and 6 to him offering Isaac his son. He said about the faith that Abraham had and how he carried out that faith by the works that he was doing. He said, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar?
Right, come on, yeah. That's right.
He didn't offer him on the altar technically. But in the eyes of the Lord, he knew that he was going to offer him. He had him on the altar. He had the knife drawn. He knew that Abraham was going to carry out his word unto him.
Hallelujah, man. Yes.
It says, when he offered Isaac upon the altar, seest thou how faith wrought with his words? Faith with his words. Abraham believed God and it was imputed unto him for righteousness when he believed the promised seed. Here he has the promised thing that God has spoken in His Word is going to be fulfilled. The things that God has spoken to you and I, He is going to fulfill in our life. But what we do can determine whether that word is going to be fulfilled in us. James is likening or referencing Abraham offering Isaac as the fulfillment of God's word to him. I believe that when we act in faith with works, that our works will fulfill the word of God in our life and the promises of God in our life. I am going to read Hebrews 13 in verse 5. I'll just read the part that I want you to hear, because the first part is not relevant to what I want to establish. Verse 5, the latter part of that verse says, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. I referenced this Thursday evening. The Apostle Paul references this word, I will never leave, as it was spoken. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Paul referencing this word, you can look it up in your commentaries. Most Bible scholars believe that this particular reference that the Apostle Paul is alluding to is the reference to Deuteronomy chapter 6 or chapter 31 and verse number 6. Deuteronomy 31 in verse number 6. In that verse of scripture which I referenced Thursday night, Moses is speaking to the children of Israel. He said, I'm 120 years old. I'm about ready to step off the scene. But he gathered all the people together. And I want all of you that are watching and listening here this morning, I want you to get your ear tuned in. That's what Moses did to the people. He gathered the people together and he wanted to tell the people something. The Lord's going to give you that land of promise. You're going to inherit that land of promise. You're going to inherit the land of Canaan. But in verse number 6, he says these words, He will not fail thee nor forsake thee. He will not fail thee nor forsake thee. This is what Bible scholars believe that the Apostle Paul was alluding to, or that verse of scripture that the Apostle Paul was alluding to in Hebrews 13 and 5. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. It's when Moses is telling the people of God, He will not fail thee nor forsake thee. And I mentioned Thursday night, after he got done addressing the people, He got Joshua next, and he got him right in front of all of the people, and he uttered the same words unto Joshua. He said to Joshua, He will not fail thee nor forsake thee. But he went a little further with Joshua, and he said, Fear not, neither be dismayed. This was the word unto Joshua. It was the word that was unto the people of God. And here in Hebrews 13 and verse 5, the Apostle Paul did not look at what Moses said to the people and to Joshua as something that was irrelevant to his day or to his hour. He said it was spoken, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He believed that that word that was spoken to the people of God back before they entered into the land of promise was the same word that he could have in this hour and in this day. I say to the church, you don't need to be fearful. You don't need to be dismayed. The Lord is not going to leave us, and the Lord's not going to forsake us. And what we need to do is to hold on to that word and allow ourselves to work out this thing in our life so that the word of God can be fulfilled in us. That the word of God can be fulfilled in us.
Amen, brother.
Listen, it's not good enough just simply
to read the Word of God.
Right.
It's one thing to read the Word of God.
That's right.
And it's another thing for the Word of God to be acted out in your life. When Abraham acted out the Word of God in his life,
yes,
when he acted out his faith,
yes,
then was that Word fulfilled in him. When we act out the Word of God in our life, then the Word of God is fulfilled in our life. Oh, the Lord said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll be with you always. I'm going to be with you no matter where you are, what you're going through. I'm going to be with you. What you and I need to do is to take that Word of God and apply it to our life and act it out. I'm not going to be fearful. I'm not going to be afraid. I'm going to trust in the Word of God. Then will that Word be fulfilled in you? The Lord purposely did things just for the sake of fulfilling His word.
That's right. Amen, brother. Yes. That's right.
And when we do what God wants us to do, and we apply that word to our life, the Word of God is going to be fulfilled in us. When you wake up in the morning, and listen, I know that every day in this season that we're in, the news is so bad, and it may get worse, but there's things that we need to understand, and we need to get in our heart and our mind. God is still in control. God is still sitting on the throne. And that God that sits on the throne has me in the palm of His hand. I just need to trust the Word of God. If He could tell the people of God that was getting ready to go into a land that they'd never been before, a leader that never has led the people before, then you're going to go in there and you're going to fight giants. You're going to fight people that you never fought before, and they trusted and they believed God. He said, you don't need to be fearful. You don't need to be dismayed.
Amen.
And they did what God told them to do.
Right, right.
When you do what God tells you to do.
Come on, come on.
So you know what you need to do when you wake up in the morning. Instead of turning on the news, you need to wake up in the morning and look to the Word of God and say, you know what? This is the day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and I'm going to be glad in it. Why? Because God is still a God in my life and God is still in control. And when you start doing that, the Word of God will be fulfilled in your life. We can only do what we can do. I'm probably one of the biggest control freaks. Well, I'm the biggest control freak that I know of. There's some that's trying to overtake me, but I...
Right.
I like to be in control.
Yeah.
But I there's things that are out of my control.
Right.
There's things that you and I... When I'm driving down the road, I'm in control of my car.
Right.
And I feel comfortable.
Right. Yes, sir. Come on now.
When my hands are on the wheel.
Right. Come on now. That's right.
I'm not as comfortable.
Yes, come on.
When my wife's hands are on the wheel.
Come on now.
But when my hands are there, I feel in complete control. I feel I got better judgment. I feel I can make a turn. When an oncoming car is coming, my wife will sit there. And I'm thinking, when is going to turn?
Yeah, come on.
I don't say that.
That's all right.
Because I've got wisdom. I don't say that to her at that time. I wait till I get behind the podium. I just tell everybody. I'm sitting there. I feel comfortable. When I'm driving down the road, I can only control my vehicle. I need to be aware of my surroundings, be aware of what's going on, be aware of my speed, be aware of the laws, just be conscious of everything and be in control. I cannot control the hundreds and thousands of cars that pass me going the opposite direction that are only inches away from me. I can't control the oncoming traffic, but I can't control my vehicle. We can only do what we can do. Put the rest in the hands of God. Lord, I need you to watch over me. Lord, you know what's behind the wheel of that car is coming. I just need you to watch over me. And you know what? I have found the Lord to watch over me when I was not so much in control.
Right. Yes.
There's been times I've been weary and nodded off and drifted to wake and thank God that there was not a vehicle coming the other way.
That's right.
I'm sure you've been there. But you know what, the Lord, he watched over me. We need to understand that God watches over us continually. God's hand is upon us.
Yes, sir.
We just do what we can do. Wash your hands.
That's
right. Stay safe. Right. Keep distance. Do all the things that the government officials are telling us to do. That's all that you can do. Put the rest of it in the hands of God.
Amen. Yes. That's absolutely right.
I told this story before, and I'll tell it as I close. God knows our future. He knows our end from the beginning. The story was when I was just a child. I can't even tell you how old I was. I have no memory of my age. All I know is I was young. And it was before I learned how to swim. I do know where I was. I was at Ridge Lake. I do know I was with some of my cousins there. I don't know who all was there, but I was with some of my cousins. And we were swimming in Ridge Lake. And at the time, Ridge Lake's not there anymore, but there was a line of this buoy line that separated the shallow end from the deep.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
And there was a deck or a platform that was out there in the middle, just beyond the buoys or the line. And I wanted to get on that platform. Well, I thought I could get there because it wasn't very far from the line. So I went under the line, and what I did not know was is that it dropped off immediately. It was just a quick drop off. I did not know how to swim. All I knew was I was just flailing, you know, just trying to. There has been many of people that drowned in this way. And I could have been one of those statistics. I don't know who the individual was. I know he was a boy, an older boy, was on the ladder to climb up the platform, and he saw me. And he just reached out from the ladder and grabbed me and pulled me to the ladder.
All right. Yeah.
I don't know who he was. Don't know his name. All I know is that I was drowning, or I was going to drown if I didn't get some kind of help. And somebody was there.
Amen.
Now, you can think whatever you want to think. You can say it was just by chance. But I believe that the Lord knows our end from our beginning. I believe that the Lord knew that I had parents that were praying for me, for His hand to be upon me, even when I did something foolish and I went out into the deep end where I shouldn't have been, and I would have sunk, I would have drowned. The Lord made sure somebody was there. Somebody was there to be able to reach out and to grab a hold of me. Oh, I remember that. I don't care where I'm at in life. I can remember the times that the Lord has protected me and has sheltered me and has watched over me. I'm going to just trust the word of the Lord this morning. I'm just going to hold on to His word. I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you.
Amen. We stand morning. What we do is so important so that the Word of God can be fulfilled in our lives.
That's right.
If you want the promise of God to be fulfilled in your life, you need to do
right
what His Word says. You've got to act it out.
Yes.
You've got to continue to walk by faith and to trust in Him. Are we in difficult times? Yes, we are. But God has us. God knows where we are. I'm just going to trust in Him. You know, that triumphant entry into Jerusalem was actually His final days of His earthly ministry. The Lord was going to complete His work. The Lord, who was ushered into Jerusalem with cheers and hosanna and praises unto Him, was soon going to find Himself betrayed, denied, and backs turned on Him. But it didn't stop Him from continuing to do the work. Why? Because for the joy that was set before Him, the Scripture says He endured the cross, despising. I believe the joy that He saw before Him was His church, His kingdom, that promise that was going to be fulfilled, His seed being at the stars of the heaven. That joy that was before Him caused Him to keep going on. When things get hard, just keep the faith. Understand that God is King. As they play and sing this morning, wherever you are this morning, I would pray this morning that you would take a moment and that you would just talk to the Lord. That you would talk to the Lord this morning. That you would pray, that you would worship. Put your trust and put your faith in Him.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Just have faith in the Lord this morning. Church, we're going to get through this. Everything's going to be all right.
Yes, mighty God.
The sun is going to shine again.
It will.
We will be together enjoying the blessings of the Lord as a body.
Amen.
Just be faithful unto the Lord.
Right.
Hold on to His word so that the word can be fulfilled when you hold on to those.
Yes, sir. Amen.
When you feel alone, hit that word down. I'll never leave you.
Yes, sir.
I'll never forsake
you. Yeah,
you might feel alone.
Yeah.
Like the writer that wrote the poem, The Footprints in the Sand.
Right.
When he thought he was walking alone.
Right.
He was not alone.
Right.
The Lord is carrying
him.
There's times we feel alone. But hold to the Word of God. That's how the Word of God is fulfilled in us. When Abraham thought, this ain't the way it's supposed to be. He believed God, and it was repeated of no matter what the adversity is. I do want to remind you, Brother Mike Carney, you appreciate his willingness to do that and help us with that. And I appreciate him going to the Facebook page and managing that for us. I really do appreciate it. I guess I've learned to appreciate it more because of what we're feeling. But now, when we set this up, sometimes we'll go ahead and realize how the impact that we're going to have. So God bless you. We appreciate you being with us today, listening to this service here today. I trust that the Word of God be a blessing to you and a help to you. So tonight, 7 o'clock, Mike Coyne will be ministering to us. We'll be back Thursday at 7 o'clock for our Bible study. And we'll just work through this thing.
Yes, sir.
It's different for me to preach them to you.
Right. That's right. Go ahead.
But you know what? God will have to do it all. Sure. Do appreciate your views. Let's go to the Lord as we conclude this with the Lord. Here the Lord be coming through your presence this morning. But praise upon our hearts. Thankful, Lord, for your faithfulness to us. Lord, I pray today that this word, Lord, will be launched in our hearts. Lord, let it be embedded in our hearts. Lord, God, that it will not ever be removed. Lord, let it be a help and a strength to us, O Lord. Lord, help us to do the things that we need to do so that the word can be fulfilled in us. Go with your people, go with each and every one. Keep your hand of protection upon each and every one of us. Blanket this assembly. Blanket your people, Lord, with your divine protection. Lord, we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Yeah.
God bless your heart.